What a blessing it is to see the saints enjoying the worship experience. I'm a firm believer that if you're going to come to worship, you ought to enjoy it. And you ought to put something in. Lord, to get something out. Amen. Thank God for the Reverend Clergy, Reverend Primo leading us in worship. Bishop Hudson leading us in that fervent prayer. All of our leadership members and friends, those watching television broadcast and our online members, we praise God for you. So good to see Brother Maurice Williams. He's back from Kansas City. We went to funeralize his mother. We were in touch with him, and we praise God that it's well with her soul. And the family was able to be there with their mother. Say amen for Brother Williams. Amen. Praise the Lord. Good to see Brother Jonah. Chris had a little spell this week in the hospital, Deacon Bond. Prayers went up and he's in church this morning. Anybody want to hear about the power of prayer? And you trust him. He will hear your prayers, answer your prayers, and desires to bless him openly when he's blessed us privately. Amen. Thank God for the singing sisters this morning. Thank you, Dr. Jones. Wonderful singing aggregation. Brings us the kind of contemporary flavor. I was telling Bishop Hudson in the back that Canaan is a blend of the best of the old school and the best of the new school. Amen. Old time religion is still good. Some of the new blended together, not to be extreme on either end. But you have the Old Testament and the New Testament makes up the Bible. Amen. I want to continue our series in the Gospel of Mark. We're preaching the Gospel of Mark this summer until the fall. Mark 2, beginning at verse 13. Gospel according to the record and witness of Mark. He went forth again by the seaside, and all the multitude resorted unto him, and he taught them. And as he passed by the saw and saw Levi the son of Alphaeus sitting at the receipt of custom, and said unto him, follow me. And he arose and followed him. And it came to pass that as Jesus sat at meat in his house, many publicans and sinners sat also together with Jesus and his disciples. There were many, and they followed him. And when the scribes and the Pharisees saw him eat with publicans and sinners, they said unto his disciples, how is it that he eateth and drinketh with publicans and sinners? And when Jesus heard it, he said unto them, they that are whole have no need of a physician, but they that are sick. I came not to call the righteous, but sinners to repentance. Amen. We'll talk from the subject, salvation by the seaside. Salvation by the seaside. Jesus Christ was never off duty. He never left his prophetic priestly post. He was an opportunist. He was one who was about his Father's business. He was one who was acutely aware of his surroundings, knowing that all sheep were not found, that there were those who were lost, who needed the good shepherd. And here in this powerful story, this parable, we see Jesus strolling by the seaside. The sea was beautiful, blue and rolling. It was not a tempest sea, but it was a calming sea. There were many boats on the sea. There were fishermen on the sea. There were people who were in commercial business, handling their business at the sea. And Jesus, he walking and strolling by the seaside in the calm of the day, in the cool, in the precious environment that his God had created. He strolls and he walks by, and in his peripheral vision, he saw this man sitting at his seat of custom. He saw a man named Levi. Levi, the son of Alphaeus, was a tax collector. He was not an honest tax collector. He was not one who had deep integrity. He was not an honest tax collector. He was like an IRS agent, if you will, of the day. His dishonesty came when he had to pay or turn over to the Roman authorities that which was required. But he would also put some in his own pocket. Perhaps there was not a minimum wage. Perhaps he was not getting paid by the hour. But he would turn in the taxes to the Roman authorities, but he would also keep some for himself. He was by the seaside. Perhaps people, Deacon Murphy, would get on that boat and come to see the tax collector. He had positioned himself strategically where the taxpayers didn't have to go too far to pay their taxes. You know, we don't like paying our taxes. Often we don't like paying them on time. But Levi, he positioned himself by the seaside to make it convenient for the people to access him. Now this Levi fellow was known for doing what he was doing. He was an outcast. He was not accepted by the people because nobody wants to give their money to a crooked businessman. Somebody talk back to me. And if you're gonna be in business, make sure you have integrity. If you're gonna be in business, make sure if you say you open at 9, don't stroll in at 10:30. Make sure somebody talk to me. We support your business, but make sure you are doing things decent and in order. It's not always what color you are, sometimes it's what kind you are. I wish I had three reasons in here. So this fella had a bad reputation. for being a shallow and crooked, if you will, a man of no integrity. And he was positioned by the seaside. And here is Jesus, praise the Lord. Here's Jesus just strolling after a preaching crusade, after ministering to people and healing. If you see the story before this story, you see Jesus walking on the seaside after he had preached and taught and healed. And he noticed in his peripheral vision this fella, Levi. He went over to him while he was sitting at his table and said to him, simply follow me. Beloved, whatever you're doing this morning, Jesus knows where you are. Oh, bless his name. Regardless of the condition of your heart, regardless of what's going on in your life, the Lord is walking by the seashore, the seaside of your life. And Jesus did not give a sermon, a dissertation. He did not get into a conversation, a back and forth. He simply knew who he was, and better yet, he knew what he needed. Let me say to you, beloved, thank God you're in the house of God this morning, and Jesus knows exactly who you are, and better yet, he knows exactly what you need. Oh, bless his name right now. You have to understand, he says to this man, Levi, follow me. These two words, follow me. Yes, a certain man by the name of Levi, Jesus says to him, follow me. This is the greatest invitation known to humanity, these two words. Jesus makes a divine offer to a human being who knew that he needed what God could give him. And Jesus simply said to him, follow me. This is the charge and the challenge and the commission of Jesus Christ and the church of Jesus Christ. We must continue to tell people, to tell the world, to tell those who are bathed in religiosity, who have not gone into spirituality. They have a form of godliness, but deny the power thereof. They sit in pews, but Christ doesn't sit in their heart. They come to church, but the church is not in them. Jesus is saying to you this morning, follow me. Just simply follow me. I am the good shepherd, follow me. I am the true vine, follow me. I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man will see the Father except by me. Follow me, I am the door. Follow me, I'm your healer. Follow me, I'm your deliverer. Follow me, I'm the Messiah. Follow me, I'm the bishop of your soul. Follow me, I'm your elder brother. Follow me, hallelujah, I'm your savior. Follow me, I'm your master. Follow me, I am your way maker. Follow me, I'm the balm in Gilead. Follow me, I'm the rose of Sharon. Follow me, follow me, follow me. Levi was following the money, but he needed to follow the master. Be very careful who you follow in this world. Be careful who you follow. This call to salvation, this call to discipleship is simple. Follow me. Thank you. Follow me. And in verse 14 it says, and he arose. And followed him. This is important. Jesus offered salvation, and Levi accepted. Without hesitation, reservation, or provocation. He said, follow me. And he arose from his seat. and followed him. Someone today, the Lord is issuing a call to you.
Come on now.
You are watching on television, if you're watching online, wherever you are, you're in this sanctuary. The Lord on the seashore has stopped by your table. Asked you to get up out of your seat. Your seat of selfishness. Your seat of pain. Your seat of bondage. Your seat of depression, oppression, and suppression. Your seat of anger. Your seat of carnality. Your seat of church attitude. Your seat of seeking mammon. Your seat of humanism. Your seat of secularism. Your seat of making God second and money first. He said, get up out of your seat and follow me. This brother, don't let me get bombed. This brother didn't ask questions. Brother Tariq, he didn't ask for an interview. He didn't get into an exchange. The story says he arose and followed him. I was sinking deep in sin, far from the peaceful shore, sinking deeply. But the master of the sea heard my, what did Levi cry? No, but the Lord knew him. I don't want to go on any further, but I'm going to stop right here for a minute, then I'll go on a little further. The Lord knows you better than you know yourself. You sitting in church this morning,
yes, sir.
Don't become superficial. Ask the Lord to come by your seat. Come by here. Dear Lord, come by here. Somebody needs you, Lord. Come by here. Somebody's crying, Lord. Come by. Somebody's in pain. Come by. And oh Lord, come by here. Follow me. And he arose and followed him. When the Lord says, follow me, he has your best interest in mind. His ways are not your ways. His thoughts are not your thoughts. And there's a witness in here that you have been following the Lord. And you love where he's leading. I said there's a witness in here. You are following the Lord. You have the call. And you have I will follow.
Yes, sir.
Where he leads.
Yes, sir.
I will follow. And he got up out of his seat.
Yeah, he did. Yes, he did.
The key word there is obedience. When the Lord asks you to do something, just keep it simple. Tell somebody around you, just keep it simple. Obey him. And follow him. And it came to pass. That as Jesus sat at meat in his house. Now look at the transition here. Jesus said to him, get up and follow me. He obeyed and followed Jesus. And then Levi now asked Jesus to follow him to his house. Where sinners were sitting and eating and drinking. Public.
Come on now.
Religious types.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
People people hurting, the bound, the bruised, they were all in the house. God about his seat and invited Jesus to his house. Jesus and his disciples. And there were many that followed him. Can't you see they left the seaside? Out of obedience. Something happened to Levi. A change happened. And what he received, he wanted to share with us. Now I just need to tell you right here, this Levi was changed. His name was changed. Levi is the Matthew of the New Testament. The Lord changed his name from Levi to Matthew. You must know that when you say yes to the Lord, he's going to change your name. Your name goes in the book of life. Not only did it change his name, but he changed his heart. When you follow Jesus, he will change your heart. Is there a witness in here? I mean, when you really sincerely take him, he will change your heart. Thirdly, he changed his occupation. He went from a tax collector to a gospel writer. Oh, bless his name. And then he changed his occupation. He went from a tax collector to a gospel writer. He went from doing bad things to spreading good news. Is there a witness in here that since you've been following Jesus, you don't do what you used to do. You don't say what you used to say. You don't go where you used to go because he's given you a new mission, a new purpose, a new spiritual occupation. Oh, bless his name. Yeah, he changed him by the seaside. He became a disciple. And so come to my house. Jesus invited, Levi invited Jesus to his house. Verse 16, and when the scribes and Pharisees saw Jesus eating with the publicans